I've got a little bit careful when I first start off here, because I'm speaking from the perspective of somebody who's seen quite a bit of change. Some of you have actually started only just a few years ago, but some of the change won't be quite as significant. One of the things that's actually been very marked in the last 30, 40 years is the growth of cynicism. We're very cynical these days about institutions, about leaders, about church, about anything that's traditionally been solid ground. And in fact, a fellow by the name of Jedediah Purdy wrote a book. It's got a shocking title. It says, the title is, For Common Things, Irony, Trust and Commitment in America Today. Now, it's not a very catchy title. This guy is only 24 years of age and he's a graduate of Yale and Harvard Universities. And here's what one of the critics wrote about this particular book. He said it's a precocious diatribe against the sort of media-savvy detachment that passes for intelligence and maturity. The ironic individual, Purdy writes, is a bit like Seinfeld without a script. At ease in banter, versed in illusion, and almost debilitatingly self-aware. In his opinion, that's Purdy's opinion, the price of such crippling cleverness is social stagnation and private emptiness. Now, you're going to stay with me tonight because we're going to say all sorts of things that if you're used to just a bit of kind of superficial mind with banter, will go straight over your head. Alright? Here's what this guy is saying. He's saying basically in this day and age it's become so cool to be cynical that it's almost impossible to be serious about anything. Even those things that we need to be serious about. And that's one of the major changes that's taken place in my lifetime in the last 30, 40 years. These days, we have kind of just got this mindless banter about things that are actually quite serious. Of public speech, for example, Purdy says this, it's become, in many cases, a ritualized contest of increasingly disembodied rhetoric. See that? That really hit me. Because you know what, when you listen to people like, remember the show was on a couple years ago called The Panel? That's probably too old now, it's on about 3 years ago, alright? Or you've got shows like The Chasers. Or you've got shows on the ABC and a lot of our channels which are made up of all sorts of modern people who talk a whole lot of disembodied rhetoric about things that are serious, never coming to any conclusions, cynical about leaders, cynical about authority, cynical about life, get a laugh from everybody, get great ratings, and then we all go to bed. That may be the state of modern things, but the question that gets raised in all of this is where do we find hope in a world like that? I think it was Oscar Wilde who said this, a cynic is the person who knows the price of everything but the value of nothing. And I kind of get that feeling when I watch shows like The Chasers and these panel shows and these people on the ABC and there's lots of rhetoric about all this serious stuff and nobody wants to take responsibility for it and help us find the way through it. It's like we know the price of everything but we don't know the value of anything anymore. So where do we find hope in a culture like ours, a post-modern? I find it very, very interesting that things have shifted again in my lifetime. When I was a child, when I was a boy, people even who weren't Christians went to church at least twice a year. You know when that was? Christmas and Easter. They don't do that anymore. What have become the two most sacred days on the Australian calendar? Anzac Day and Australia Day. That is it. Australia Day is all about our heritage, that is who we are as a people, that is about our identity, that is about what gives us a great sense of belonging. Anzac Day has actually become a spiritual day for the nation. It's where we derive our motivation, our pride, our integrity. And do you realise that about 25 years ago, there was a move to shut Anzac Day down? Some of you that are old will remember. I can still see the headlines that, you know, we are glorifying war and it's not a good thing to be glorifying war and raising up children with this know, glorifying of the past. Today, last Saturday, we had a cold, wet, wintry day. And we had record crowds at every shrine in Adelaide. Today, people want to go to Anzac Cove in Gallipoli. Today, Anzac Day has become the touchstone for our spirituality, not church. And so the question remains, what's actually happened to our culture? Now what I want to do is I want to go back and trace what's happened to our culture in the last 1600 years. Told you it's going to be a long night. We'll just do this later. I want to break it up into three periods of history. The first period of history is what's known as the pre-modern world, or you might call it the Middle Ages. And it starts from about 500 AD, goes through to about 1500 AD, about 1,000 years. Now let me just explain what this period of history was all about. It was a period where religion was the source of all truth and authority. I mean, the Catholic Church steadily was growing in enormous power and authority. Then you had the birth of Muhammad in what year? Tell me. 570 AD, right? And in 610 AD, when he was 40 years of age, he had all these revelations, and then you had the birth of Islam. And then in about 622, when you had Muhammad, who was having all sorts of problems in Mecca with all sorts of other tribes and religious beliefs and so on, there was this great warfare, he retreated off to Medina, and that's when Islam began to become very militaristic. And so began, in a sense, the birth not only of religious Islam, but militaristic Islam. And so this was a time when religion, not just Christianity, religion in this period of history was being birthed and exerting enormous power in the world as we knew it then. It was also a time in the birth of the monastic movement. Lots of people retreating from the world and going into monasteries to try and get pious and get close to God. It was a time of religious idealism where you had the Crusaders, for instance. What century were they in, anyway? The Crusaders. About 900, about 1000 AD. And the Crusaders were people who, Protestants, who went into Jerusalem to try and drive out the Muslims who had taken over the city of Jerusalem. So the Crusaders tried to recover, if you like, the spiritual ancestry of Christianity. And it was a very bloody and gruesome time of Protestant history, was the Crusades. You had great thinkers like Thomas Aquinas and Thomas a Kempis. You had people like Joan of Arc. You had the Inquisitions. By the way, can anybody tell me what an Inquisition was in those days? What was it? You've heard about the Inquisition. You know what they were? Let me tell you what they were. The Inquisition, and there were plenty of them, not just the Spanish Inquisition, they were everywhere. The Inquisition was the use of torture where there was spiritual disobedience. Let me tell you, this was a tough time to disagree with the church. Although every now and then I wouldn't mind bringing back the torture. I think a couple of old demons I could write on the rack, but nonetheless, the Inquisitions were a shocking time. You see, you've got to understand here, you've got a very powerful, select group of religious people. People like me, who were seen in the church as having all spiritual knowledge, all power, and people like you just sat there and you had no way of knowing the truth because it was bound up with people like me. And that's why over a period of time, both in Christianity and in other religions, it became a very difficult time for the ordinary person because they were slaves to people who had all the power. And that's why in around about 1350, John Wycliffe was born, and John Wycliffe saw the terrible abuses in the Catholic Church, and he had a desire to put a Bible in the hands of every man and woman and boy and girl that wanted to read. You know how thankful we would have been to people like John that said, you shouldn't be at the mercy of people like me. You should be able to open the Bible and read it for yourself. yourself and find out about what God really says. And that's what John Wycliffe did. So here's this period of the pre-modern world. The second period of history is the what we call the modern world. And that's this period of history from around about 1500 to just around when a lot of you were.